Father God, not only are you the high King of heaven, but you're the Father who wants us to come sit in your lap and to enjoy just being with you. You created us in your image. You sought to have a relationship with us. And when sin entered in, you sought to make a way where there seemed to be no way. All because you love us. And we're so glad you do. And I pray, Father God, that you would continue through your Holy Spirit to minister to us, to speak to the parts of our heart that need to hear the good news of the gospel, that Jesus came to save us and to give us abundant life. And abundant life comes from dwelling with the giver of life, from having a relationship with the one who spoke the world into being. That's who we get to have a relationship with. Thank you. Continue to bless us. In Jesus' name, amen. I want you to think for just a minute about somebody who you're really crazy about. Think about somebody who you not only would drive all day to get to be with, but you'd actually like to spend all day with him once you get there. Maybe it's a child, maybe it's a spouse, maybe it's a parent, maybe it's a best friend. But I really want you to, I'm asking you to think of that person. Okay. You got it? You got somebody? What do you think about that person as beautiful? Tell me something that's beautiful about that person. Maybe it's their smile. Some of us have these little things running around our houses, crawling around our houses. Maybe it's their eyes. It's like, oh, they have such beautiful eyes. But what if it's their feet? Today, Paul is going to say, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring the good news. Guess what? All of y'all have beautiful feet. I almost went this week and got a pedicure so I could wear my flip-flops, but still my feet are not technically beautiful in that way. Does anybody here know why the marathons, a lot of marathons are like 26.2 miles. I mean, that's kind of the standard for a lot of those. And it's like, you know, there's a lot of theories behind it. But the one, I listened to a couple of great messages to this week. And one of the messages that I listened to was kind of talking about the history of this because he was talking about how beautiful are the feet. So anybody who can speak Greek, that is, yeah, Fred. We're going to call him Fred or Fed. Pheidippides, whatever. Okay, so way, way back, Athens is being threatened, and they need the Spartans to come and help them because they are outnumbered about 4-5 to 1, and so they send him to Spartan. Now there's a problem, and that is that, as you can see, from Athens to Sparta is 150 miles. Now, dude, he runs that in 2 days. I could go 150 miles in about a month if I was in a car, okay? But this guy is not a professional. He's not a citizen athlete. He's a soldier. What does he do? He doesn't fight. He runs. He is a messenger. He trains in what he eats, he trains in what he does, and this guy covers 150 miles in 2 days. And he gives this message to the Spartans. Now, if you just ran, Ralph, if you just ran 2 days, how long would it take you to get your breath to be able to say, hey, we need some help over here? Ralph was like me. I'd need a week to recover so that I could make those sounds. But he gets there and he tells the Spartans, he goes, look, we're under attack. We need you. Will you come? They said yes and no. What do you mean, yes and no? Well, yes, we will absolutely come, but according to our religious customs, we can't come until the moon is full. Well, when's the moon going to be full? Oh, about 6 days from now. Well, thanks for nothing. And so what does he do? Well, he goes back 150 miles in 2 days to deliver the message. While he's been gone this 4 days running this 300-mile marathon, he gets back and he finds that one of the commanders of the Athens army, that he said, you know what, here's what we're going to do. While the enemy is sending their horses back, and they are anticipating that the Spartans are coming, and so they're thinking we're going to go back and we're going to fortify our city and then we're going to wait for them, let's attack them now. And they literally rout the opposing army. So Fred is not done. Now he gets to run from Athens to you can't see it on the map there, but a little place called Marathon to deliver the good news. And it happens to be about 26.2 miles. And he runs there, and this is the reason that he's known for this last stretch. He's not known for the first 150 or the second 150 or the total of 300. What he's known for is this last one, because he literally runs there with the good news, we won, and then he collapses and he dies. And, you know, as you can imagine, he's remembered for that. How beautiful are the feet of those who bring the gospel of peace. Man, this guy, dude, they were loving on this guy. Man, you brought us the best news ever. One long time ago, I was sitting in my office. I'd gotten a phone call from a young guy. He'd been in our youth group. He'd been in my youth group. And he was one of those kids. He was the also came kind of kid. You know, he wasn't really part of our church, but his best friend was part of our church, and so he would come to a lot of the events and all this other stuff. Well, now he's called me. He's in college, or maybe just got out of college. He calls me, and he says, "Brother Mike, yeah, you know, we're going to do a concert at our church, and I'm going to such and such church, and I'd like to come by and pick your brain about how to best to do this concert and all this other stuff." And so that was kind of cool. So I was honored, and he shows up, and he comes in, and we begin to talk about this, and I find out that, you know, he did really well in college, and now he's working at this company there in White House, 31W Insulation. He's kind of working his way up there, and he's gotten real involved in a church, and so he's taken the lead to have this concert. And about that time, he goes, "But the real reason I'm here is that my pastor's been talking to us about your spiritual heritage, and told us that we should go if we can, and we should go and talk to those people who've had something to do with our spiritual heritage." And he said, "So you remember how you'd always get around to telling how to get saved at everything you did? See, it's not new. I've been doing this for a long time." And I go, "Yeah." He goes, "Well, one of those times that you told us how to be saved, I got saved and I just didn't tell you." And now he's getting ready to go to seminary, and he's surrendering to the ministry. That was a day I was ready to put my feet up on the desk and go, "Man, I got some good looking feet." Because God had used me. In my attempt, he'd used me to help bring somebody into the gospel of peace. Church, that's what Paul is saying to all of us. He's not saying, okay, some of you are preachers, some of you are teachers, some of you are evangelists. Okay, so if you're not a preacher, teacher, evangelist, you just get to sit at home. Not everybody is called to be an evangelist. Not everybody is gifted to be evangelist, but all of us are called to evangelize. And how do we evangelize? We go around and we tell, "Let me tell you how good my God is." But Mike, what if they answer tough questions? You look at them and you go, "I don't know. I'll ask my preacher. I'll ask somebody. There's probably a YouTube you can, you know, how to fix whatever. It's all there out there. But what I do know is I was lost and now I'm found. This was my life before Jesus and this is my life now." So in Romans chapter 10, we're going to maybe cover a little bit of this. And if you have any questions about my trusting my worship leader / daughter, I completely do. And when the Holy Spirit's leading, it's his service anyways. So we're cool with that. If you only leave me 5 minutes, that's fine. Romans chapter 10, verse 14 and 15 says this: "How then will they call on him in whom they have not believed? How will they believe in him who they've not heard? And how will they hear without a preacher? In other words, how will they hear without someone telling them? How will they preach unless they're sent, just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news of good things. How will they know about Jesus unless someone tells them? Since they have to hear, who will tell them? And remember, this isn't about professional preachers. That's a mistake. What he's saying is, so you guys get to tell them. Remember, he's talking to a Jewish audience and to a Gentile audience. And sometimes everything he's saying is to both of them. And sometimes it's just to that one group or it's just to that other group. And I think a lot of this is he's talking to the Gentiles, possibly about going to those Jewish folks. But at any rate, he's telling us we have the opportunity to go. Ephesians 4, 10 through 12. This is the scripture I referred to earlier. He who descended in himself also... He who ascended far above all the heavens so that he might fill all things. And it's talking about God. It's talking about Jesus. It's talking about the Holy Spirit. And he gave some as apostles. Truly, there are some that are that's their specialty. Some as prophets. That's their specialty. Some as evangelists. That's their specialty. Some as pastors and teachers. That's their specialty. But why? For the equipping of the saints to do what? The work of service, the building up of the body of Christ. If you have a person who they're the calling on their life, they're apostles, they're not just there to, I'm the apostle, but they're there to help us learn how to do that. If they're a preacher, preachers, it's not the preacher's job just, I get to preach, nobody else preach, don't ever preach. Actually, I want you to preach all week, okay? I'm here to try to show you how to do that. If you're an evangelist, then yes, you're... We all know people who are evangelists, and I mean, they just walk up to somebody and go, boo, and the person's like, oh, I want to be saved, you know? And some of us are like, we've learned the Roman road, we've done this, we've done that. I've never had any success. Your success isn't whether or not the person says yes. Your success is, did you do what Jesus said to do, which is to go and tell? So that's kind of cool. That's what we get to do. So we're training others is what those of us who are gifted in certain areas, we're supposed to do. We don't all have the gift of evangelism, but we do all have the call to evangelize. Now back to Romans chapter 10, verses 16 says this. However, they did not all heed the good news, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? Well, what if they don't believe? Paul was saying, look, they're not all going to believe. But that doesn't mean you don't tell them all. You just tell everybody. Well, who should I tell? Tell everybody. We used to call it cherry picking. I'm going to walk through and I'm going to find the one person who I think might say yes. No, not that person. Well, no, that person's left-handed. That'll never work. They're too tall. Just tell them all. And then see what the Holy Spirit does with that. Verse 17. So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. So if they have faith, the word will have an effect. Right. But also, if they hear the word, they will have faith. The effect of the word is that they develop faith. So what do we want to do? We want to give them our faith. We want to loan them our faith. What Sarah was doing here today, she was loaning some faith to some of y'all who are going, I just don't know that I've got the faith. And she's saying, I have got the faith. I'm going to share my faith with you until your faith gets big enough that you've got faith, and then you can begin to share faith with other people. We give our faith away, but every time we give our faith away, it's just like love. The more we give it away, the more it grows inside of us. So if they had faith, okay, hearing the word has an effect. The effect of hearing the word is faith that then gives the ability to take action in belief. And remember last week we talked about what is belief. Belief is life changing. It's not just I believe it's not going to rain today, or I believe that, you know, this or that. I'm investing in this. I believe it that much. Verse 18, but I say, surely they have never heard, have they? Indeed they have. Their voice has gone out into all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. Now, Paul is quoting two scriptures. One is from 1 Kings, but the one that's more noticeable is the one from Psalm 19. Psalm 19.